Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Made in the USA, The Rise and Retreat of American Manufacturing, by Vaclav Smil, narrated by Adam Barr. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Preface. Long experience has taught me that too many people approach books dealing with complex topics with too many preconceptions, and hence become easily disappointed if the content does not reflect at least some of them. I am afraid that a book about the rise and retreat of American manufacturing, written at the beginning of the second decade of the 21st century, will be particularly subject to such a reception. Those economists and policymakers who do not see, as was famously said, any difference between potato chips and microchips, who favor unrestricted globalization, and who celebrate the loss of U.S. manufacturing jobs as a desirable evolutionary step toward a purely service economy, will dislike the book's insistence that manufacturing does matter. Equally, those economists and policymakers who abhor every aspect of globalization and argue for increased protectionism will dislike my strong agreement with the calls for greatly expanding U.S. exports of manufactured goods. If this is not an economic analysis written by an economist promoting a particular view or advocating a specific policy, it is also not a history of America's technical prowess written by a historian trying to conform to a distinct paradigm. I am a scientist with a lifelong devotion to interdisciplinary studies, and I have published many books on complex technical, historical, and economic topics. But when writing this book, my goal was quite simple: to tell a story, though one that is well documented and thoroughly referenced. That story is truly epic, multifaceted, and, to me, also endlessly fascinating. There are many reasons why the United States came to hold such an exceptional position in the world, but manufacturing does not usually come first to mind. This book explains why and how manufacturing became such a fundamental force in creating and advancing the United States' economic, strategic, and social might. It traces manufacturing's rapid rise during the last decades of the 19th century, its consolidation and modernization during the pre-World War II decades, its role in enabling the world's first mass consumption society after 1945, and its post-1974 challenges and most recent reversals of fortune. How does the story end? Well, it does not. It keeps unfolding. And even a relatively near-term outcome of this process is beyond our ken. That is why I am content neither to offer general policy recommendations for creating optimal conditions for manufacturing's growth, nor to advance strong arguments for specific changes aimed at preventing its decline. Washington, D.C. has no shortage of special interest organizations and think tanks to do that, and some have done so in a thoughtful and comprehensive manner. What I will do, convinced that no advanced modern economy can truly prosper without a strong, diverse, and innovating manufacturing sector whose aim is not only affordable, high-quality output, but also to provide jobs for more than a minuscule share of the working population, is review some of the recent calls for change made by those concerned about the future of U.S. manufacturing, and explain in some detail some of their principal recommendations. Fundamentally, this is a story about the country's past achievements and its more recent failings, and, as always in my books, I will not make any forecasts. Hence, I will not answer the question of whether American manufacturing will experience a true renaissance, as its dwindling proponents hope, or whether it will, in employment terms, if not in total output value, become an ever more marginal economic sector, as many economists belonging to the "serving potato chips is as good as making microchips" school equanimously anticipate. All I can say is that I see the odds of America's true manufacturing renaissance and the sector's further retreat to be no better than even. Introduction. In 1899, Ransom Olds began to assemble his Oldsmobiles, essentially buggies with an engine under the seat. 2 years later, he marketed his curved dash, America's first serially produced car. 2 years after that, Cadillac Automobile Company began selling its vehicles, and in 1903, David D. Buick set up his motor company. In 1908, Oldsmobile, Buick, Cadillac, and 20 other car and part-making firms came under the umbrella of General Motors, established by William Durant, Buick's general manager. The company kept growing and innovating, and by 1929, it had passed Ford in annual sales. It survived the Great Depression and prospered during World War II, when it was the largest maker not only of military trucks, but also of engines, airplanes, tanks, and other armaments and ammunitions. In 1953, President Eisenhower named Charles E. Wilson, the company's president, the U.S. Secretary of Defense. When Wilson was asked during his confirmation hearings about any possible conflict of interest, he answered that he foresaw no problems. "Because for years I thought what was good for the country was good for General Motors, and vice versa," a reply that became known as an iconic but reversed in retelling claim that what's good for General Motors is good for the country. By 1962, when its share of the U.S. car market peaked at 50.7%, GM was the world's largest manufacturer, with an apparently assured prosperous future. But that was before OPEC, and before Honda and Toyota began selling cars in the United States. By 1996, when GM moved its headquarters into the glassy towers of Detroit's Renaissance Center, its share of the U.S. car and light truck market was less than 33%, as the company became infamous for poorly designed models built with too many defects. A decade later, GM was a hopelessly failing corporation, and when it declared bankruptcy on June 1, 2009, its U.S. market share of light vehicles was just 19.6%, its share of cars just 16%. The bankruptcy eliminated not only the preposterous Hummer, but also a long-running, since 1926, Pontiac brand, and Saturn, set up in 1985 as a different kind of car company to challenge the Japanese designs. Even after the company's stock was refloated in November 2010, the government kept a 34% stake. This trajectory, from the world's largest automaker to bankruptcy and bailout, embodies the rise and retreat of American manufacturing, with one big difference. Unlike GM, thousands of America's electronics, textile, shoe, furniture, car parts, or metalworking companies were not too big to fail, and simply disappeared during the past two generations. But the outcomes are not foreordained, and the GM story also carries an intriguing message of rebound. In 2011, helped by a partial economic recovery, GM sold more than 2.5 million vehicles in the United States, and a total of just over 9 million worldwide, reclaiming its global primacy, while Toyota, beset by its own quality and delivery problems, slipped to fourth place, behind Renault Nissan and Volkswagen. And Ford rode out the economic downturn without any government help. In 2008, it had only 14.2% of the U.S. market, compared to its peak of 29.2% in 1961, while in 2011, the sales rebound, 2.1 million vehicles sold, raised its share to 16.8%. But this is no return to the days of American automotive dominance. Deindustrialization has been a nationwide phenomenon, and Detroit has been the epicenter. The view southwest from GM's gleaming towers reveals a stunning cityscape where abandoned houses and lots, overgrown with weeds and wild trees, vastly outnumber the remaining inhabited houses. No wonder, even as recently as 2000, the U.S. auto industry employed 1.3 million workers. But by July 2009, the total had been nearly halved to 624,000. Post-2000 employment in the entire manufacturing sector followed a similar trend. After World War II, manufacturing jobs rose steadily, reaching a peak of nearly 19.5 million workers in the summer of 1979. By 1980, in the midst of a recession, the total was still 18.7 million. By the end of 1990, it was 7% lower at 17.4 million. By the end of 2000, it had hardly changed at 17.2 million. But a decade later, it was just 11.5 million, BLS 2012. Of course, many economists have promised that all those who lost their jobs in manufacturing would be absorbed by the endlessly capacious service sector. But there was no net job creation during the first decade of the 21st century. Rather, there was an overall job loss. In January 2001, the United States had 132.5 million non-farm jobs, whereas in December 2010, the total was 129.8 million, a 2% drop during a decade when the country's population increased by 9.7%. The last time similar events took place was during the Great Depression of the 1930s. And as in the 1930s, the loss of manufacturing jobs, a total of 5.6 million lost between the end of 2000 and December 2010, was the principal reason for this failure even to maintain the overall employment level. At the same time, between 2001 and 2010, the aggregate U.S. trade deficit, mostly resulting from imports of manufacturers, was nearly $4.4 trillion, adding to trillions of dollars in budget deficits, $1.4 trillion in 2010 alone, and making the United States the greatest debtor nation in history. These are the realities that led me to take a critical look at the evolution, achievements, failures, and potentials of U.S. manufacturing. I take a long-term historical perspective to explain the technical accomplishments and the economic, political, and social implications of the remarkable rise of America's goods-producing industries to global dominance, their post-1970s transformations and retreats, and the likelihood of their survival and expansion. I wrote this book because I wanted to narrate the great and a truly nation-building story of U.S. manufacturing, and because I believe that without the preservation and reinvigoration of manufacturing, the United States has little chance to extricate itself from its current economic problems, meet the challenges posed by other large and globally more competitive nations, and remain a dynamic and innovative society for generations to come. To write about manufacturing is to deal with fascinating stories of quintessential human activities that created modern societies and enable their complex functioning. But this truism is not a widely shared perception in a world long since labeled post-industrial, in economies whose added value is dominated by services and not by making things, and in societies whose attention is swamped by consumption and the exchange of sounds, images, and words belonging to a new, immaterial e-universe. The fact that all of this depends on an enormous variety of manufacturers goes inexplicably unacknowledged. Even more inexplicably, the entire realm of converting raw material inputs into a myriad of finished goods is seen as a relic from the industrial past that appears passé compared to modern virtual realities. And then there is the archaic term of the activity itself. What, these days, is really manufactured? Made, fascio, by hand, manus, in affluent economies. Only a shrinking variety of artisanal products, while the mass of consumer goods has been made by machines for decades, as mechanization, robotization, and computerization have replaced even those functions that were thought of not so long ago as safe preserves of human skills. Going a step further, affluent countries have been doing less and less of any kind of manufacturing. As Adam Smith counseled in 1776, if a foreign country can supply us with a commodity cheaper than we ourselves can make it, better buy it of them. But would Adam Smith, a rational man, approve of the fact that not a single fork or dining plate, Not a single television set or personal computer is made in the United States. And that importing all these goods, and tens of thousands of others, has deprived the country of millions of well-paying jobs? Not likely, especially as he advised to buy it of them with some part of the produce of our own industry, employed in a way in which we have some advantage. Smith, 1776. But trade statistics make it clear that any of America's comparative advantages fall far short of the aggregate value of those cheaper imported commodities. The situation that has brought, starting in 1976, chronically large trade deficits. Smith thought that this trade, which without force or constraint is naturally and regularly carried on between two places, is always advantageous. Would he still think so, given these realities of mass unemployment and chronic deep deficits? Virtually any mass production of goods now has some connections to foreign trade, much as it has social, political, and environmental consequences on scales ranging from local to global. And although manufacturing now receives hardly any public attention compared to the overwhelming focus on the virtual e-world, it remains the single largest source of technical innovation, and its advances transform every branch of the modern economy. The United States' outsized role in creating, expanding, and improving the world of manufactured goods easily justifies a retrospective appraisal for these achievements. The manufacturing sector's recent weaknesses, failures, and retreats, masked to a large extent by its continued growth in aggregate absolute terms, offer a timely and sobering opportunity to dissect some of its problems and challenges. 1. Why manufacturing matters. Claims about the dematerialization of modern economies and about a post-industrial world in which manufacturing does not matter are costly misinterpretations of fundamental realities. Not only the wealth, but the independence and security of a country appear to be materially connected with the prosperity of manufacturers. Every nation, with a view to those great objects, ought to endeavor to possess within itself all the essentials of national supply. Alexander Hamilton, Report on Manufactures, 1791. Life enriched and burdened by an enormous and still increasing variety of manufactured products is a recent phenomenon. All but a few people in pre-industrial societies lived with a minimum of simple possessions, as only the richest could own good quality artisanal products made as unique items or in small series. And even the products made in larger quantities, bricks and earthenware containers, simple metal objects, were not cheap enough to be easily affordable. The poorest peasant families owned, as many of them still do in Asia and Africa, only some cooking pots and perhaps a few utensils, often just a single bed, and in societies where cereals were the staple food, some containers to store a small amount of grain. Even during the early decades of Western industrialization, the items used or owned by new urban immigrants rarely went beyond a rudimentary stove, a few simple pieces of furniture, and a single change of clothes. There is no better and certainly no more visually captivating testimony to this material progress than Material World, A Global Family Portrait. In this book, the families of 30 nations, chosen for their representative status in their respective societies, display all of their pitiful, or extensive as the case may be, belongings arrayed in front of their dwellings. Menzel, 1994. Another impressive collection of images portraying the gap between the worlds of misery and excess is a series of photographs that won the third Prix Pictet and was established under the title Growth, Barber and Benson, 2010. But perhaps the best indicator of what makes up the necessities of life in modern mass-consuming society comes from Pew Research Center polls that identified the things Americans claim they cannot live without. The list of these necessities grew between 1996 and 2006, with the highest percentage gains for microwave ovens, 68% of people could not live without them in 2006, a 36% gain in a decade. Home computers, dishwashers, clothes dryers, and home air conditioning units. Taylor, Funk, and Clark, 2006. Only the subsequent economic downturn brought a U-turn. By 2009, all of the previously named items were perceived as much less necessary, all suffering double-digit declines, than in 2006. Moran and Taylor, 2009. Even so, two-thirds of respondents could not do without a clothes dryer, and 88% could not do without a car. American history offers an unequaled example of a society defined by the large-scale amassing of goods. Getting richer in Europe and Japan has always been a comparatively more subdued affair. America's private and public hoarding of manufactured goods has been going on for about 150 years. In public terms, we should not think only of vehicles, buildings, or dams owned by the federal government. We should think also about all of that military hardware, from spy satellites and fighter planes to aircraft carriers, nuclear submarines, and intercontinental ballistic missiles. In its early stages, private material acquisition had undoubted quality of life benefits, from refrigerators to telephones, from elevators to vaccines. But more recently, the purchases, or more accurately, increased debt obligations, have been marked by excess and a lack of taste, a trend exemplified by living in custom-built faux French mansions and driving Hummers, civilian versions of a military assault vehicle. The most recent burst of such ostentatious acquisitiveness is taking place in the rapidly modernizing economies of China and India. Although it has been limited to urban elites, its intensity has already made these, on average, still very poor countries the world's leading markets for ridiculously overpriced luxury goods. There can be no doubt that the notion of a successful modern life has become overly defined by the possession of manufactures. For billions of people, those goods remain beyond reach, but not beyond hope of acquisition. The importance of manufacturing thus seems trivially obvious. And yet we hear claims that post-industrial societies have found ways to dematerialize themselves as the magic of software drives the electronic worlds where connection, information, and knowledge become superior to mere objects. Such thinking might charitably be labeled misguided. An unadorned judgment is that it is simply nonsense. Others may concede our material needs, but tell us that post-industrial societies do not have to make anything and can simply import all the manufactured products they need. The advantages of outsourcing and international trade have been extolled by the promoters of globalization for decades, but the arrangements have many inherent problems. Bhagwati and Blinder, 2009. Fletcher, 2011. There are many instances in which moving some segments of manufacturing abroad makes overall sense, and many more instances in which vigorous foreign trade is desirable and beneficial. But an ideologically based pursuit of unlimited free trade, an excessive dependence on imports, and the systematic outsourcing of entire industries will eventually weaken even the strongest economies. Claims that manufacturing has lost its importance, that we should not be worried about its decline, that the prosperity of modern economies comes from services, and that exporting high-value-added services can secure earnings sufficient for importing all the needed manufactured goods, are all wrong. In this chapter, I will demonstrate the quintessential position of manufacturing in the economy of any large, prosperous, modern nation. Manufactured societies. Many possessions owned by families in modern, affluent countries are necessary in order to live with a modicum of dignity. Beds, plates, cutlery, glasses, simple clothes, shoes, soap, and towels are in this category. In cold climates, we cherish well-insulated walls, good doors and windows, and reliable furnaces or stoves. Everywhere, we would like to have a convenient kitchen and lights after dark. For individual commutes to work, reliable vehicles or bicycles, trains and subways and streetcars are essential. Other items of material consumption are clearly dispensable frivolities, a category to which a critical inspection could assign most of the items found in modern North American households. But by a simple count, perhaps most of the items most families own belong to that huge in-between category that does not imply any opulence, but that makes daily life comfortable and enjoyable. Such objects range from small appliances to books, from garden tools to sports equipment, from furniture to gadgets for the reproduction of music. And while most people in traditional societies spent most of their lives within the narrow confines of their villages and towns, mass-scale mobility has been one of the most distinguishing features of modern societies and has required the large-scale construction of transportation infrastructure, prime movers, and conveyances as we travel often enormous distances for business or vacations. Behind all these material needs is a multitude of specialized manufacturing industries that draw on raw resources from all continents and from offshore waters, employ hundreds of millions of workers worldwide, and are never finished with their work, as new products are created to replace worn-out or obsolete items. And given the large numbers of consumers that can afford to buy these products, now globally on the order of 1.5 billion for higher levels of expenditures and another 2 billion or so at intermediate levels, manufacturing had to cease to be what the term's Latin roots imply, literally, made by hand. That is now an anachronism as far as all but a tiny share of everything available on today's market is concerned. High levels of mechanization and automation and the ubiquitous use of electricity-powered tools and machines became the norm, allowing large quantities to be produced at acceptable costs. The same is obviously true about food consumed in modern societies. In traditional subsistence societies, crops were grown mostly for immediate consumption by peasant families. But in modern societies, crops are grown overwhelmingly for distant markets, and because of high rates of meat and dairy intakes, most crops are actually destined for animal feeding and not for direct consumption by humans. This arrangement requires the mass manufacture of such items as synthetic fertilizers, pesticides, and herbicides needed to sustain high yields, the production of tractors, implements, and combines for timely and efficient cultivation and harvests, and the availability of trucks and ships to carry foodstuffs to distant markets. Because of these inputs, it has been possible to feed 7 billion people, provide an excessive food supply for nearly 2 billion, and reduce the total number of malnourished people to less than 1 billion worldwide. Smil, 2001, 2011. Other existential necessities include the energy supply for households, industries, and transportation, along with the drilling rigs, pumps, compressors, well casings, pipelines, tankers, refineries and mines, coal cleaning plants, trucks, trains, and bulk carriers needed to extract, process, and distribute fossil fuels. The final uses of these energies take place in boilers, raising pressurized steam from massive electricity-generating turbines, in furnaces, and in prime movers. Gasoline-fueled car engines are now the most numerous converters. Large diesel engines powering container ships, the most efficient kind, and jet engines used in commercial airplanes, the most reliable designs. Smil, 2010. The largest category of final uses consists of machines, appliances, and light emitters to convert electricity to thermal, kinetic, and electromagnetic energy. Or we can simply look at the extremes of our lives, where objects surround us as we are born and as we die. Sheets, gloves, stethoscopes, injection needles, drugs, and monitors charting every heartbeat until the final flatline. Truism it may be, but it bears repeating in a society where most minds are divorced from the fundamentals of making things. Well-being in the modern world is defined by our dependence on a multitude of products, physical objects that must be made by first transforming raw materials, by smelting, refining, reacting, separating, synthesizing, into a wide variety of intermediate products, ranging from metals to plastics, from lumber to flour, which are turned by further processing and final assembly into marketable items. This description comes close to the official definition of these productive activities without using that less-than-ideal term, manufacturing. The U.S. Census Bureau defines manufacturing as a sector that comprises establishments engaged in the mechanical, physical, or chemical transformation of materials, substances, or components into new products. The assembling of component parts of manufactured products is considered manufacturing, except in cases where the activity is appropriately classified in Sector 23, Construction, USBC, 2010. This official definition embraces both the mechanical and the human component of the activity by describing the manufacturing establishment as plants, factories, or mills, and characteristically use power-driven machines and materials handling equipment. However, establishments that transform materials or substances into new products by hand or in the worker's home, and those engaged in selling to the general public products made on the same premises from which they are sold, such as bakeries, candy stores, and custom tailors, may also be included in this sector. But the awkwardness does not end here, and the most obvious problem is with inclusions and boundaries. Virtually all modern manufacturing entails management, payroll, and accounting, and most of it depends on continuous design improvements, research and development activities, and often just-in-time deliveries of parts and components by a variety of carriers. An international comparison shows that in 2005, services purchased by manufacturers from outside firms were 30% of the value added to manufactured goods in the United States, and between 23% and 29% in major EU economies. Another comparison shows that in 2008, service-related occupations in manufacturing accounted for 53% of manufacturing jobs in the United States, between 44% and 50% in Germany, France, and the UK, and 32% in Japan. Levinson, 2012. U.S. manufacturers thus employ fewer people in actual production operations than in allied service-type functions. And while many products of modern engineering still fundamentally look outwardly like their early predecessors, they are now very different hybrid systems of parts and services. Cars are the best example of this transformation. They are still complex mechanical constructs. Modern vehicles contain some 30,000 parts. But now all of their functions, from engine operation to the deployment of airbags, are controlled by computers, and the requisite software is more complex than that on board fighter jets or jetliners. Charette, 2009. GM put the first electronic control unit, ECU, in an Oldsmobile in 1977. And today, even inexpensive cars have 30 to 50 ECUs, requiring some 10 million lines of code. And the 70 to 100 ECUs in luxury cars need close to 100 million lines of codes, compared to the 6.5 million lines of code needed to operate the avionics and onboard support systems of the Boeing 787 and the 5.7 million lines of code needed for the U.S. Air Force's F-35 Joint Strike Fighter. Electronics and software now account for as much as 40% of the cost of premium vehicles, and software development alone claims up to 15% of that cost, or at $10 per line of code, on the order of $1 billion before a new model even leaves the factory. Cars have been transformed into mechatronic hybrids, assemblies of parts unable to operate without complex software. That is why TASI, 2010, argues that we should think of manufacturing as a value stream rather than a static category. But the operational definitions and data collection procedures used by national governments and international organizations are not designed to reflect these complex realities. When these associated services are provided by manufacturing establishments, the North American Industry Classification System, NAICS, views them as captive and treats them as manufacturing activities. But when the services are provided by separate establishments, they are classified to the NAICS sector where such services are primary, not in manufacturing. NAICS, 2008. because many manufacturing companies, large and small, now routinely outsource design and R&D activities, as well as market research or payroll, McPherson and Vanchon, 2010, this has become a significant source of undervaluation. And there is more. Defining manufacturing as the transformation of materials into new products hinges on the definition of new, and hence on an inevitably subjective setting of boundaries. The NAICS offers a longish list of activities that are considered to be suppliers of new products, starting with bottling and pasteurizing milk and packaging and processing seafood, through apparel jobbing, assigning materials to contract fabricators, printing, and producing ready-mixed concrete, to electroplating, remanufacturing machinery parts, and tire retreading. That logging and agriculture are excluded seems only natural, but the NAICS also leaves out many activities that could logically be seen as obvious kinds of manufacturing, including the beneficiation of ores assigned to mining, fabrications on construction sites assigned to construction, bulk breaking and redistribution in smaller lots assigned to wholesale trade, the custom cutting of metals and customized assembly of computers assigned to retail trade, and the entire sector of publishing and the combined activity of publishing and printing assigned to information, because the value of the product to the consumer lies in the information content, not in the format in which it is distributed, i.e. the book or software diskette. USBC, 2010. In light of these realities, there is no doubt that the lack of a modern, realistic, and inclusive definition of manufacturing is not only of statistical interest, it is a barrier to judging the sector's true performance and to formulating informed policies. Van Opstal, 2010. Finally, there are differences between the two ways of measuring the sector's output. Manufacturing production quantifies the value added by an establishment minus its purchases of inputs from outside sources, or the sector's sales minus its purchases of raw and intermediate materials and energy. The measure remains the same regardless of whether some services, such as accounting or design, or even actual manufacturing, are done by vendors rather than in-house. In contrast, goods output quantifies all spending on domestically produced goods and all goods exports minus the cost of all manufactured imports. These measures are not identical, as the latter, goods output, includes the retail cost of imported goods. The sum of subtracted imports refers to the payments for foreign production and delivery, not to the purchase price, as well as the costs of domestic transportation, marketing, and financing of the operations. Steindl, 2004, found that in the United States, goods output has been increasing relative to manufacturing production for many years. He explained the puzzling divergence by a rising share of imported goods, increased service inputs to the sale of all goods, and a larger share of post-production service inputs to market consumer as opposed to capital goods. All of this has important consequences. First, we are stuck with an anachronistic term that not only fails to capture the fact that modern manufacturing has become highly and almost universally mechanized, but also gives no hint that computers and computer-controlled devices are now used in every stage of manufacturing, from design and prototyping to the actual machining, fabrication, quality testing, and packaging of finished products. Second, while the quantitative evaluation of the sector's weight in an economy has always depended on a somewhat arbitrary delimitation of manufacturing's boundaries, this definitional weakness has grown to become a major complication, as modern manufacturing is unthinkable without large and growing components of R&D, the processing of high-quality special components, customized assembly, national and global marketing, and post-sale servicing, now commonly online, with major producers often outsourcing or subcontracting many to most of these steps. These practices also make country of origin an increasingly questionable categorization. Chances are that any but the simplest of today's machines or devices have been assembled from components that originated in more than one country and that may in turn contain subcomponents made elsewhere. besides making any meaningful assignation of country of origin impossible. This reality can also greatly inflate the value of exports if they are, as is standard, assigned to the country whose workers performed the final assembly. Rassweiler's 2009 teardown of Apple's iPhone is a perfect example of these complications. iPhone's key components, its memory, display, screen, camera, transceiver, and receiver, come from Japan, Toshiba, Germany, Infineon, the United States, Broadcom and Numenix, and South Korea, Samsung. And the final assembly is done by Honhai Precision Industry, a Taiwanese company trading as Foxconn and operating a giant plant in Shenzhen, Guangdong Province. In 2009, exports of iPhones from China to the United States added about $2 billion to the U.S. trade deficit when the accounting uses the total manufacturing cost. But the assembly in China added less than 4% of the total, which means that the value added in China raised the U.S. trade deficit by less than $75 million, and that more than 96% of the $2 billion bill actually represented transfers of components, with more than three-quarters of their value originating in Japan, Germany, South Korea, and the United States. Before I start retracing the history of American industrial production, I must refute two persistent myths concerning modern manufacturing. The first sees manufacturing as a progressively less important endeavor because technical innovation constantly displaces, in absolute or relative terms, mass. And the quantities of material inputs and manufactured products that are required to perform identical economic functions decline with time. The dematerialization of securities, for example, is now complete. No companies or stockbrokers issue paper forms, as everything has become an electronic book entry. And most people are aware of the inverse relationship between computer mass and performance. In 1981, IBM's first personal computer had 16 kilobytes of RAM and a mass of 11.3 kilograms, or just 0.7 grams per byte, IBM 2011. I began to write this book in 2011 on a 4-gigabyte RAM Dell Studio laptop weighing about 3.6 kilograms, and hence having the mass of about 0.9 micrograms per kilobyte of RAM. This dematerialization reduced the mass per unit of RAM ratio to only about 1.3 times 10 to the ninth of its 1981 value in 30 years. In 1981, the mass of about 2 million personal computers was on the order of 20,000 tons, and their aggregate RAM was on the order of 30 gigabytes. In 2011, the more than 300 million computers sold worldwide weighed only about 1.2 megatons, or only about 60 times the mass in 1981, while their aggregate RAM was more than 1 exabyte, 10 to the 18th bytes, or 30 million times greater. With a 1981 mass to RAM ratio, the computers sold in 2011 would have weighed 840 gigatons. Nearly two orders of magnitude more than all the metals, plastics, glass, and silicon used worldwide, or more than 200 times as much as all the materials used annually in the United States. But this example is also extraordinarily exceptional. Trends from the e-world, driven by an ever-denser packing of transistors on a microprocessor, microchip, have been a realm unto themselves. And nothing remotely similar has taken place in other fields of manufacturing. Impressive improvements have been common in many branches of modern manufacturing, but reductions in the mass per unit of performance ratio by seven orders of magnitude are utterly impossible in other major industries, be it ferrous or color metallurgy, chemical synthesis, furniture building, or food processing. Indeed, in most branches of non-electronic manufacturing, even reductions of an order of magnitude, that is, new designs performing the same functions with only a tenth of the mass of earlier products, are uncommon. Perhaps the most common example of such a success is the heavy diesel engine. In 1897, the first machine had a mass-power ratio of more than 330 gigawatts, and in 1910, the first engine installed on an ocean-going ship rated about 120 gigawatts. While today's most powerful marine diesel engines rate nearly 30 gigawatts, a reduction of an order of magnitude. Wärtsilä, 2012. Schmiel, 2010. On the other hand, there have been many cases of reducing the unit mass of products by 20 to 50%, with examples ranging from the mass of aluminum soft drink cans to the mass-power ratio of modern electric locomotives. But all of those substantial relative reductions have not added up to any absolute declines in demand for materials. Available data show that during the past generation, even the affluent economies, which already enjoyed the world's highest rates of per capita consumption, saw further increases in aggregate material inputs, while the world's most populous and rapidly modernizing countries, above all China, India, Indonesia, and Brazil, experienced extraordinarily high rates of demand for virtually every kind of material. As a result, there has been no aggregate global dematerialization as far as any metal, any construction material, any plastic, or any kind of biomass is concerned. The demand for these manufacturing inputs is reaching historical highs because even the most impressive relative reductions have been more than negated by the combination of continuing global population growth and rising per capita demand for virtually all kinds of industrial and consumer goods. Manufacturing and service economies. The second view I wish to expose is more fundamental and even more dismissive than the first one. It does not posit any diminishment of mass. It simply sees modern manufacturing as a largely, if not an almost entirely, dispensable activity, a matter of secondary importance that can be taken care of by simply importing whatever is needed from the cheapest foreign sources and paying for the purchases by earnings from high value-added services, whose contribution now dominates GDPs in all affluent countries. Or, as one of many recent conclusions favored by economists has it, manufacturing's declining share of GDP is something to celebrate. Perry, 2012. Manufacturing seems easy to dismiss in societies that find the post-industrial label, originally introduced by Bell, 1973, and Illich, 1973, the most fitting description of their realities and aspirations. The notion that manufacturing does not have to be a major concern of effective economic policy or an important part of long-term national aspirations, and the logical extension of this notion, namely that low-cost foreign suppliers can cover any need in a global economy, has been embraced for two very different reasons. Because of an entropic perception of economic development and, more commonly, by a majority of economists, because of a mistaken interpretation of an indisputable reality. The first line of reasoning has to do with the obviously unsustainable nature of economic growth that created and continues to support modern societies. Binswanger, 2009. In the long run, the growth imperative of modern economies is incompatible with the second law of thermodynamics, called by Nicholas Georgescu Rogan, 1971, the most economical of all physical laws. From this perspective, accessible material at low entropy is the most critical variable, and minimized entropic degradations should be the foremost goal for any rational society. Or, to rephrase this challenge by referring to several recent books, because materials matter, Geiser, 2001, we should stop shoveling fuel for a runaway train of economic growth, Check, 2000. Embrace the logic of sufficiency, Princeton, 2005. Confront consumption, Princeton, Manietes, and Konka, 2002. And make a break with the throwaway culture, Slade, 2006, by reasserting self-control, Offer, 2006. And according to the most radical reinterpretation, even a steady-state civilization would not be enough. The only thermodynamically acceptable society would have to be supportable without any fossil fuel input and would have to minimize its material throughput. Georgescu Rogan, 1971. In less radical interpretations, these ideas have found expression since the 1980s in calls for sustainable economic growth tinged with varying shades of green, in arguments for service economies aiming at wealth without resource consumption, Stale, 1997, and in proposals for economic degrowth, Flippo and Schneider, 2008, or in a variant phrasing, for managing prosperous economies without growth, Victor, 2008, Jackson, 2009. And the time to act may be here, as the denouement of exponentials has already begun, Morgan, 2010. Obviously, any material and energy-intensive mass-scale manufacturing is an anathema to these efforts, and the declining fortunes of modern manufacturing are seen as desirable steps toward a long-term goal of true sustainability. The second line of reasoning leading to unconcern about manufacturing's declining fortunes, and one that is much more common and widely accepted, sees that trend as an essential component of a highly desirable evolution marked by a steady decline in the sector's contribution to the national economic product, and by the obverse trend of an inexorably rising importance of services. These two trends, one downward, one upward, characterize all modern economies. In Germany, the value added by manufacturing stood at about 32% in 1970. It was down to 21% by the year 2000 and to 18.9% by 2010. In Japan, the shares for the same years stood at 35%, 22%, and 21.2%. UN, 2012. In the United States, manufacturing's share of GDP declined from 27% in 1950 to less than 23% by 1970 and to 13.3% in the year 2000. After a small rise to 14.1% in 2007, it declined to 12.9% in 2009, then rose a bit to 13.5% in 2010. I should note that all of these comparisons are based on the UN's data using ISIC categories, International Standard Industrial Classification, manufacturing being category D. In contrast, the U.S. domestic accounts using NAICS codes 31 to 33 indicate even lower shares, 14.2% in 2000, 11.2% in 2009, 11.7% in 2010, and 12.2% in 2011, and only about 11% when subtracting foreign-made components of U.S.-made products, USBC 2012A. In 2011, government services contributed about 13%. Financial services, including insurance and real estate, topped the sectoral ranking at about 20%, and all service sectors, including all trade, accounted for about 77% of the country's GDP. Manufacturing is not the only economic sector that has been seen as increasingly unimportant when compared to services. Agriculture, fisheries, and forestry add an even smaller share to the total economic product. In 2010, they accounted for about 1% in the United States and Germany, nearly 1.5% in Japan, and an exceptionally high share, 2% in France, UN 2012. A brief reflection suggests that this low share is not an appropriate way to value the sector's importance in any populous, affluent country. We need only to imagine the EU economy without French or German farming, or trying to replace all the food in any affluent, populous country by imports, or the consequences of losing U.S. farm exports, the world's largest source of traded grains and meat. In 2011, U.S. agriculture accounted for only 1.2% of the country's GDP, but the absurdity of the claim that this small share makes farming a marginal economic activity is best exposed by comparing the loss of that share with the disappearance of an identical share contributed by financial services. Complete loss of agriculture's 1% is not obviously equivalent to reducing financial services' share by 1%. The first loss would bring large-scale suffering and death, not only inside the country, but worldwide, because there is not enough food on the global market to feed the United States solely by imports, and even Brazil could not make up for the loss of U.S. food exports. The second loss actually took place between 2009 and 2011, when the sector's share of GDP fell by 1.4%, even as the economy was slowly recovering from the worst post-World War II recession it has faced. And one could argue that a further decline might be desirable if the loss entailed all those speculative derivative transactions that have been one of the principal causes of many recent economic hardships. Analogously, using the declining share of GDP to judge the importance of manufacturing in the U.S. economy is to rely on a wrong metric, because the sector offers benefits unmatched by other economic activities. Dusterberg and Prieg, 2003, MI, 2009. Above all, manufacturing creates many backward-forward linkages that include many traditional jobs, from accounting to job training, as well as entirely new labor opportunities in e-sales, global representation. As a result, sales of every dollar of manufactured products support $1.40 of additional activity, while the rate for transportation is about $1, and the retail sector and professional and business services generate less than 60 cents for every dollar of final sales. MI, 2009. Because of its own needs for better educated labor and its multiple linkages to intellectual services, transportation, and wholesale and retail operations, manufacturing also acts as a powerful motivator for supporting and expanding suitable training and education. Losing manufacturing means reducing opportunities for skill-oriented education, and as the sector accounts for about two-thirds of R&D, its decline means losing innovation capacities and economic multiplier effects. Moreover, manufacturing is a key enabler of the traded sector's strength. And in a globalized world, it is impossible to have a strong national economy without internationally competitive trade. Atkinson et al., 2012. In the U.S. case, the import of manufactured goods is the single largest cause of the country's chronic trade deficit. While perhaps the best way to reduce that drain is, particularly given the country's relatively low trade intensity, through the expansion of manufactured exports. Making the case for perpetuating a strong manufacturing sector in America's service-dominated economy thus rests mainly on three fundamental realities. First, and most notably, manufacturing has been the principal driver of technical innovation, and technical innovation, in turn, has been the most important source of economic growth in modern societies. Second, despite extensive offshoring, large labor cuts, and a deep erosion of many formerly thriving sectors, apparel, consumer electronics, leather goods, machine tools, primary steel, U.S. manufacturing remains very large and, in absolute value-added terms, still a growing part of the nation's economy, and a reversal of this long-term trend would make the existing socioeconomic challenges even harder to tackle. Third, a relatively low intensity of manufactured exports has contributed to the country's trade deficits, and a further retreat of the U.S. manufacturing sector would eliminate any realistic hope for their eventual reversal. The first reality means nothing less than crediting manufacturing as the key generator of America's, and indeed the world's, post-1865 economic growth. This attribution has been revealed by efforts to account for the sources of economic growth that was needed to create the world's first mass consumption society. How has U.S. manufacturing achieved those unprecedented levels of high-volume production and high labor productivity? Classical explanations credited the combined inputs of labor and capital as the key generators of economic growth. Rostow, 1990. Not until 1956 did Abramovitz show that this combination explained just 10% of the growth of per capita output and no more than 20% of labor productivity growth in the U.S. economy since 1870. Abramovitz, 1956. Most of the large residual, known as the total factor productivity, TFP, had to be due to technical advances, and Solow, 1957, supplied its first startling quantification. concluding that 88% of the doubling of the overall U.S. labor productivity between 1909 and 1949 can be attributed to technical changes in the broadest sense, with the small remainder the result of higher capital intensity. In his Nobel lecture, Solow claimed that the permanent rate of growth of output per unit of labor input depends entirely on the rate of technological progress in the broadest sense. Solow, 1987. Dennison, 1985, found that 55% of the U.S. economic growth between 1929 and 1982 was due to advances in knowledge, 16% to labor shifting from farming to industry, and 18% to economies of scale. As the latter two variables are themselves largely a result of technical advances, above all, mechanization, which released rural labor to industry, Dennison's account implies that innovation was behind at least three-quarters of economic growth during that period. These early studies of TFP viewed technical change as an exogenous variable, with new ideas coming from the outside to be eventually adopted and internalized by enterprises. This view ignores many ways of continuous innovation within industrial enterprises and the feedbacks among producers, innovators, and markets. An endogenous explanation of technical change as a process induced by previous actions within an economy began with Arrow's 1962 work and became commonplace a generation later, Romer, 1990. But Grossman and Helpman, 1991, argued that the decompositions of Solow's residual may be inappropriate for drawing any inferences about the underlying causes of economic growth, because the identified factors are not independent variables, but are dynamically linked. And they also concluded that the exogenous-endogenous dichotomy is more of an externally imposed division than a description of reality. And as Solow, 2000, pointed out, the claim that the tempo of economic growth is a function of a simple variable that can be manipulated by a policy is hardly persuasive and is unsupported by historical evidence. Perhaps most notably, a massive post-World War II increase in U.S. R&D manpower and funding aimed at producing waves of technical innovation has not resulted in a comparable rise in economic growth. DeLue and Soete, 1999, offered an explanation for this lack of correlation between higher post-World War II R&D and productivity growth, concluding that those activities concentrated increasingly not on product innovation, but on product differentiation, which improves consumer welfare, but does little for economic growth. The latest puzzle regarding the effects of technical innovation on economic growth rates was the apparent failure of the nearly universal adoption of the microprocessor to generate a surge in U.S. manufacturing productivity. David's 1990 explanation of this paradox came in the form of a historical analogy with electricity generation, whose impact on manufacturing productivity became very strong only during the 1920s, 40 years after the beginning of commercial electricity generation. The low rate of labor productivity growth, averaging less than 1.5% per year between 1973 and 1995, was reversed during the late 1990s, and at 2.5% a year, it almost equaled the 1960 to 1973 rate, Dale et al., 2002. While there may be no perfect way to disaggregate the relative contributions of individual factors driving economic growth, there can be no doubt that innovation, rather than labor or capital, has been its most important driver. In turn, there is no doubt that technical innovation in modern Western societies has originated overwhelmingly in the manufacturing sector. The sector has always been the principal locus of independent invention and technical improvements. In the closing decades of the 19th century, manufacturing companies were the first entities to foster systematic research in their factories and laboratories. And from these often surprisingly modest origins grew the modern R&D sector. Governments have become major sponsors of this effort through national research institutions, universities, and aid to industries. But its principal locus, particularly after subtracting the government spending on military projects, remains in the industrial/manufacturing sector. In 2007, global R&D expenditures reached about $1.1 trillion, with more than 60% coming from industry. U.S. industry funds about 67% of all R&D. The EU mean is about 55%, but nearly 70% in Germany, and shares in East Asia are above 60%, NSF 2010. Another estimate credits the top 1,400 firms with spending $545 billion on R&D in 2007, with the largest 100 firms accounting for 60% of that total. And the key role of manufacturing innovation is obviously true even when describing great transformation in non-industrial sectors, be it modern agriculture, transportation, or communications. Global agriculture could not feed 7 billion people without the Haber-Bosch synthesis of ammonia, without inputs of pesticides and herbicides, and without field machinery, including irrigation pumps. Intercontinental travel time could not shrink without gas turbines powering jetliners, and the global shipping of bulk materials and countless manufactured goods would be much less affordable without the diesel engines that propel massive tankers, cargo carriers, and container ships. Communication could not be instantaneous and global, and no modern service sector based on data storage and processing, banking, finance, retail, hotel and travel reservations, could exist in today's convenient form without microprocessors, whose manufacturing had to be preceded by the invention of integrated circuits a decade earlier, which in turn was preceded by the commercialization of silicon-based transistors. Perhaps the best way to stress this fundamental causality is not to use such terms as technical advances, invention, or innovation, but to choose Mokyr's broader and a more fundamental term, useful knowledge, and to say that only when it was applied, with an aggressiveness and single-mindedness that was not known before, it created the modern material world. Mokyr 2002, page 297. Only those who believe that modern societies can prosper without manufacturing need to be reminded that manufacturing has been the dominant mode of translating this useful knowledge not only into all the material riches, but also into convenient services that are the hallmarks of modern societies. The second point, the formidable size of America's manufacturing, is easily illustrated with readily available national statistics. When the comparison was done in constant $2005 dollars, using official exchange rates, the sector was still the world's leader, with $1.762 trillion in 2010, compared to China's $1.654 trillion, accounting for about 19% of the global manufacturing output, UN 2012. In current monies, $2010 dollars, China moved to the lead in 2010, $1.922 trillion versus $1.856 trillion. But the relative difference remains large, more than fourfold, with the U.S. 2010 per capita rate at about $6,000 and the Chinese rate at about $1,400. The per capita level of manufacturing effort was also higher in the United States than in France, $4,100, Canada, $4,900, and Italy, $5,200, but roughly 20% lower than in Germany, $7,600, and 25% lower than in Japan, $8,500. Another way to appreciate the magnitude of the U.S. manufacturing sector is to realize that in 2010, the value it added to the country's GDP was higher when compared in nominal terms than the total GDP of all but seven of the world's economies, a bit behind Brazil and well ahead of Canada. A ranking based on purchasing power parity makes the value added by U.S. manufacturing larger than all but nine of the world's largest economies, behind France but ahead of Italy. And the sector has been growing. When measured in constant monies, it expanded by about 60% between 1990 and 2010, nearly matching the growth of overall GDP, and grew by 23% between 2001 and 2010, compared to a 15% increase for the overall GDP. But these encouraging aggregates have been accompanied by huge job losses and the drastic downsizing or near elimination of entire manufacturing sectors. Dealing with the third point requires a review of the specifics of the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.